On behalf of Echo India, I, Deepa Jha, welcome you all to today's session. As you know, Echo India is doing an educational series on COVID-19 that started last week. Today, every person on earth is somehow affected by COVID, and the virus has taken a toll on both our physical and mental well-being. Hence, it becomes very important for us to know more and understand how to take care during this pandemic. Today, we are in our second session of the series, and the topic for today is COVID care tips. I would like to invite Dr. Sandeep Bhalla, Associate Vice President Projects at Echo India, to start the session. Over to you, Dr. Bhalla.
Thank you, Deepa. Welcome to today's eminent national speaker, Dr. Shashank Joshi, Padam Siri Awardee. But as you know that we are this particular series. On the other hand, if you see that there has been a sharp increase in the COVID-19 with the second wave, and already the speculations have started there for the third wave. Echo India, which is an extension for community health outcomes, is a not-for-profit organization working with Project Echo, which started in 2003 by our eminent founder, Professor Sanjeev Arora, based in University of Mexico, Albuquerque, with the intention to provide the treatment to so many patients as possible. He created a case-based learning model to mentor the local healthcare providers across New Mexico on how to treat the condition of hepatitis C. Today, it has become a global movement, and the purpose of ECHO is to democratize the knowledge so that all learn, all teach. Seeing the spread of the ECHO movement, Echo India Trust has been created in 2008 under the leadership of our chairman, Dr. Colonel Kumud Rai. He is also the chairman of Echo India, as well as the director of vascular surgery at Max Hospital. Our executive director is Dr. Sunil Anand. Has seen that this second wave has not only costed us many lives, but also anxiety of lack of beds, oxygen medicines. The surge in COVID-19 cases and deaths might be a result of many reasons, but at the same time, a revamp of healthcare system is needed. What is more needed in the today's scenario is home care management and how to take care of ourselves in this pandemic. We have been hearing about maintaining social distancing, wearing masks, face covers, regularly washing hands or sanitizing hands, being indoors, but all these are really sufficient to fight pandemic. Despite all these precautionary measures and protocols in place, we are seeing high rise of every day in the COVID cases. And if you see the yesterday number itself, we have crossed the highest number, 4.2 lakhs. And if you see the mortality also, it is around 3,980, with a positivity rate of 24.4%. So many Indian cities are reporting a chronic shortage of hospital beds, and it is also evident in this desperate cries for help on social media platform. Disturbing reports of people dying without getting timely treatment are coming from all across the country. As India battles this huge crisis, we at Echo India deeply value the role of education for our healthcare professionals. And taking the series forward, today we have our very eminent national expert speaker, Dr. Shashank Joshi, Padam Shri Awardee, who will tell us more about COVID care tips and how to keep safe and prepared for the infection. Dr. Shashank Joshi is the Dean of the Indian College of Physicians. Sir is also the Chair of IDF Southeast Asia. Sir is also the President of India, past President of RSSTI, past President of ESI, and numerous awards has won in his own career of academic journey. And he's actively involved with evidence-based work in endocrinology. And he's also on the COVID task force member of Maharashtra. And today only in the Times of India, we have seen that can Mumbai model be replicated for oxygen utilization for other cities also. I think there are so many things to know from such an eminent speaker who's leading the fight from Mumbai with the help of the various staff, with the help of various stakeholders. So I'm handing over to Dr. Shashank R. Joshi, sir, to take it over the today's session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Sandeep, and thank you, Deepaliji. It's indeed a pleasure to educate people at large. And I congratulate Echo. I didn't know what Echo was till Dr. Sandeep Bhalla joined it. I've known him from his previous assignments. And I wish you all the best. And I wish Deepali and her, Deepa and her team, Deepa Jhaji and her team, very best at ECO and all members of ECO. So we are actually facing, very unusual times. So there are two challenges in this era. You know, we have three eras. One was the BC era before COVID era. Now we are in the DC era, which is during COVID era. And we are all praying, when will that time come, which will be an after COVID era. So, you know, this is the biggest challenge we have. And what we have on us is uncertainty. We don't know, what is in for us next. Because the virus, which is a small, tiny RNA virus, is predictably unpredictable in its behavior. When we all thought that COVID is almost over, we have conquered the first wave, we suddenly saw a fast spreading mutant, invading our lives. So, as Deepa ji said in the beginning, that it has invaded every part of our life. And I'm happy that Sandeep, you have taken up this movement to educate people at large. So what I'm going to do is basically give you an overview on what is COVID, what we should do if we get COVID, how we should manage it at home, and what are the red flags, and how we should sort of go, and what are the various controversies. So a couple of things we need to understand, that COVID is a very, very simple, tiny RNA virus. But though it appears very innocent as an RNA virus, it is not as innocent as it looks like. 80% of people who get inoculation with this virus will have no symptoms, would not even know that they had COVID, and they will pass off. A good 20% of people will be symptomatic. And in those symptomatic people, we need to recognize it, we need to diagnose it, we need to isolate it, and we need to treat it. So that is the big challenge we have. So how do we diagnose COVID? Now, we diagnose COVID if somebody had high-grade fever, somebody has dry cough, somebody is out of breath. Those are the traditional big three signs for COVID. But as the pandemic evolved, we realized lack of smell or taste is a diagnostic test for COVID. If you have lost your smell and taste, it's near certain that you don't even need to do an RT-PCR. It is that accurate, particularly smell. And then we have unusual features like diarrhea can be COVID, backache can be COVID, a little pain below your leg can be COVID, simple fatigue can be COVID. So COVID came in different avatars. So the new avatar of COVID, which we are seeing now in the second wave, is the one which spreads very fast. So how is COVID spread? The COVID is spread fundamentally through a simple route, which is airborne, and predominantly through airborne droplets. So this is where people faltered, and this is where we realized that this is an airborne droplet. And because it is an airborne droplet, it is in the air. So obviously we need to mask and double mask. And if we don't double mask, and how do you double mask? If you have N95, if you're working in a COVID environment, if you are going to a hospital which you are taking care of COVID patients, you need to do an N95. If you are at home, you are going out, then you need to wear a single 3-ply surgical mask, which is 2 rupees, and cover it up by a properly fitting cloth mask. That's good enough. That's a double mask principle. And also remember that many people have recommended that if you have a COVID case at home, you should mask at home. Or whenever you have a visitor at home, it could be a maid, it could be a driver, it could be a servant, but not residing at home. And that person is coming home and going out. You still need to mask even at home for those 3 to 4 or 5 hours. So basic principles of COVID is that transmission is number one through airborne droplet. And to protect it, you need an appropriately fitting mask. And we'll have to mask throughout 2021, 2022. The strongest vaccine for COVID is still the mask. Whether there is one mutant, second mutant, third mutant, fourth mutant, Mumbai strain, Delhi strain, doesn't matter. We still need to mask. The second thing which we need to do is just wash our hands with soap and water. All the sanitizers are useful, but soap and water is good enough. The fomite-based focus on science, because whatever we talk in COVID has to be guided by science, has really come down, but you also still need to be hygienic. And the third thing is COVID also needs distancing. So we need to keep a distance of 6 feet from people, unless you are in an air bubble or staying at home. Beyond that, we need circulating air. So if you are in a closed, dingy, overcrowded, poorly ventilated environment, that's a recipe for getting COVID. But if you are in open air, you know, the windows are open, the air is being circulated, you are less likely. So avoid crowds, avoid poorly ventilated spaces. That's the next thing. So stay clean, avoid crowds, avoid ventilated poorly environments, and mask yourself. That's the COVID tips. Everybody knows it, but people got tired, people got fed up, people said this is too much, hoga to dekha jayega. And that is where that rebellious, revengeful, argumentative Indian faltered. And that probably was a mistake. And that is why it came back. So remember, every pandemic has waves. So last year was our first wave. We never realized that from small little places where COVID was not exposed, like places like Kerala, Vidarbha in Maharashtra, Marathwada in Maharashtra, which had no exposure to COVID, they picked up COVID. And from there, probably we had a possible mutant variant of concern, which was multiplying fast, spreading fast, may not be more fatal. It is probably less virulent. And probably it spread fast, recovered fast, but had more people being affected. So in the last wave, we had out of 10, if 3 people got affected in the family, in this wave, 10 out of 10 got affected. In the last wave, probably those 10 got affected, 3 got affected after 3 to 5 days. In this wave, probably in 2 or 3 days, everybody got affected. And in the last wave, we saw people predominantly in the senior citizens, people with comorbidities, hypertension, diabetes, kidney disease, obesity got it. While in this wave, we had relatively younger population without any comorbidities getting affected because they are the working population. They were going out and they got affected. So that was the big difference in COVID of last wave and COVID of this wave. We are now at the peak. As we talk, we are at the peak of the COVID second wave. Every country had waves, whether it was United States, whether it was United Kingdom, whether it was Europe, whether it was even Hong Kong is having its fourth wave now, you know. So every country had its wave. Waves will come, waves will go. Okay, there is nothing to panic, be fearful about. We have to be very, very careful. We have to be correct. We have to be scientific and we have to be appropriate. So the key word is appropriate behavior, which is very difficult, but we have to do it with a lot of logic without panic. Now, once we are walking this journey of COVID, we realized that other countries have had it. The good thing from the Indian host is immunologically, maybe because we are BCG vaccinated, we have MMR and polio, we had some degree of protection. And our case fatality rate in the first wave was one of the lowest in the world, which became a study for different populations. Even in the second wave, the ferocity of the second wave is very high. But even today, we maintain that we have still a lower case fatality rate. So I stick my neck out on that. And we have done better than many countries on planet Earth. And that we should be very proud that we can still do it, but we should not be reckless. We should still avoid crowds. We should still avoid poorly ventilated spaces. We should still ensure that we mask up when we are talking to people. And whenever we have to unmask, like for example, if you want to talk, you want to sing, you want to dialogue, please wear a mask. There is zero tolerance for lack of adherence to COVID appropriate behavior. So that's a given. So if you get symptoms like COVID, then test. So we put in the nose and in the throat a swab. And when you swab, we take an RT-PCR or a rapid antigen swab. The sensitivity of a rapid antigen is 50%. But within 1 hour, we know whether you are positive or negative. If it is positive, there is no need to do an RT-PCR to confirm it. If it is negative, don't be complacent. Isolate yourself. And still, maybe after 3 to 5 days, repeat a test if you are symptomatic. If the RT-PCR normally takes a day to come, it is sensitive up to 70%. But if you are still symptomatic after RT-PCR is negative, then you may need to do an aid like a CT scan. CT scan has been in a lot of charcha of late. But remember, CT scan has a sensitivity of 85%. It is not to be used for diagnosis unless and until you have symptoms and RT-PCR is negative recurrently, then we use CT scan for a diagnosis. Otherwise, sparingly, under medical advice, we use between 5th and 10th. So when you are at home, when you have got COVID, first thing is we try to assess the patient. Then we try to triage or transfer the patient and manage the patient. All these three things happen simultaneously. You should connect to your doctor digitally or virtually. And remember, COVID timetable is 14 to 21 days. Not a single life can be lost across India if we follow a 14 to 21 day timetable and measure our thermometer temperature, measure our pulse, measure our respiratory rate, blood pressure, and oxygen saturation on a pulse oximeter at rest and after 6 minute walk. If we do these five things and keep in touch with a doctor, you are unlikely to lose your life due to COVID. Because COVID mortality is 1 or 2%. But we don't have to be complacent at all. Many people are asymptomatic. First week, they feel, are kuch nahi hua. And then second week, they get hypoxia. They suddenly do it and die. So the first thing is that when you have this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, we need to understand that if your fever is above 100, take an ordinary paracetamol. You can take it 1, 2, or 3 times. If you have recurrent cough all the time, which is persistent beyond 3 to 5 days, we take an inhaled budesonide or inhaler. Not everybody needs inhaled steroids, but only the people who get recurrent cough. And under medical supervision, if you are at home, if you don't have any symptoms, usually the doctor will just monitor. Maybe you may need some vitamins. Usually they don't make much of a dent. But nutritionally, they might be sufficient, like taking a shot of a vitamin D 60,000 doesn't hurt. The data may not be as robust as people think, but taking 60,000 IU of vitamin D, some people take 650 milligram of zinc, some people will take vitamin C 500 mg twice a day, doesn't hurt. Okay, if you take it, it's fine. It at best is a supportive pill, but it is not the primary treatment of COVID. Okay, so most asymptomatic cases will do well on its own. We don't recommend in the first 3 days to rush to blood test, rush to do a CT scan. But if CT blood tests are done, simply do this complete blood count. Look at a test in this complete blood count called RDW, red cell width. If the RDW is more than 14.5, it's a red signal. We know that the patient can deteriorate. The second test we do is CRP. If the CRP is high, we know there's active inflammation. We need to be careful. We need to be vigilant. This patient may have to go to hospital. So simple CBC CRP is good enough. If you do a ferritin test, LDH test, D-dimer test, interleukin 6 test, it is useful, but should not send a panic signal at all. So one is that we measure the temperature, we measure the pulse, measure the respiratory rate, we measure the oxygen saturation, and we do a 6 minute walk test. So if your saturation, oxygen saturation at rest is say 99%, and then you do a 6 minute walk and drops down to 94%, it's a 5% drop. Then probably you need to contact a doctor. Or if it is below 93%, then you need to contact a doctor. You need to be put on oxygen. You need to lie on a prone position. And after you lie on the prone position, which is on your stomach, okay, get some oxygen, take some steroids, and take some low molecular heparin or an oral anticoagulant under medical supervision. That is the treatment of COVID. So if you desaturate, that is the red flag. But at home, what do we need to do? Do we need to take any medicines? Well, there are antiviral drugs. In the first 72 hours, only in the first 72 hours, for symptomatic patients, if you take an antiviral like favipiravir, it may work. It is not an hard and fast, but we give it to clear the virus faster. But only in the first 72 hours, after 3 days, it's unlikely. You must have just read recently in the newspapers that we have also now an antibody which a former US president took, which has been approved in India, which is made by Regeneron or Eli Lilly. And if you inject that in the first 72 hours, it can also clear the virus. So we have a monoclonal antibody now, and we have a favipiravir with some viral clearance issues. We have these two options. One, of course, that monoclonal antibody is not routinely available. So those are the two options. I don't think there is too much data on doxycycline, ivermectin, or azithromycin, which is given. But stay connected with your doctor. Stay connected with your doctor. Your doctor is the best judge to appropriately treat you with the resources which are available. But twice a day, keep measuring your temperature. Twice a day, keep measuring your respiratory rate. twice a day, keep measuring your saturation and do that for 14 to 21 days. Never make the mistake of the biggest challenge is 5th to the 10th day or 7th to the 14th day. That's the time we see suddenly people deteriorate. Because that is the time they go into hypoxia. And that is called as a happy hypoxia. And then, of course, you need steroids. We don't recommend steroids at home. We don't recommend anticoagulants at home. Usually, then you need to take an oxygen. And oxygen can be taken through different methods. We give, in the past, we gave a high-flow nasal cannula. Now, we don't use the high-flow nasal cannula because we have to save oxygen. Oxygen concentrators are there now at home. But remember, they are good for healing after you have recovered from COVID. If you have COVID and if you have desaturated, best is to go to a corona care center or a hospital where a doctor takes care of you and triages and decides based on mild, moderate and severe whether you need a medicine or not. So the next antiviral, see, virus should be attacked by a virus. So the only other injectable antiviral we had is a medicine called remdesivir. This should never be given at home. It is useful for moderate to severe cases who need oxygen and where the oxygen saturation is less than 23%. In them, if you give injectable remdesivir, 100 mg two doses on day one, and then 100 mg daily for another 4 days, then it will get you out of the hospital maybe a day or two earlier. It will enhance your recovery, but does not impact mortality. That means it doesn't save your life, but at best will improve the recovery and enhance your recovery. So that's how it is. That's the remdesivir. It's in short supply, but now Government of India has ensured that everybody will have remdesivir. What happens is if you still get breathless, you keep deteriorating, we start using steroids. So steroids which we use, there are two steroids. The Americans used from Michigan, the Henry Ford system, the methylprednisolone injectably, 40 mg twice a day or thrice a day. And that too for 5 to 7 days. Do not use more than that. A lot of people use 250 milligram twice a day. That should not be used. That causes a lot of high blood glucose. And later on, we are seeing a pandemic of unusual fungal infection called mucormycosis. So you need to use the right dose of steroid at the right time. The recovery trial and the only medicine which saves your life is steroid. Is dexamethasone. 6 milligram was used in the recovery trial in UK. Their 6 milligram equivalent of Indian dose is 8 milligram. You can use a injectable dexamethasone that will save life. And if you are rushing for a hospital, but you're not able to get to hospital, you're rushing for oxygen, you don't have oxygen and patient is breathless and patient saturation is low, give steroid. Even if you give oral steroid at home, it is going. Because it will definitely be useful, but do not use it in the first 7 days and the virus is actively multiplying. Virus actively multiplies for the first 10 days. After that, now you are ICMR said there is no need to do a test to find out whether you are negative or not. After 10 days, you are good enough. The virus may still be positive, but it is a dead virus which is being pulled out. So remember, that is the rule of the thumb. Now still, after taking steroid, if your oxygen requirement keeps going up, and in 24 hours from 2, 4, 8 liters, it goes up to 20 liters, then you are going through a cytokine storm, lung storm. And if there is a lung storm, then sometimes we give unusual drugs, which are also monoclonal antibodies. One of them is used for rheumatoid arthritis called tocilizumab. It is a global production. It is out of stock right now. Or we use a Make in India compound called itolizumab, which is Make in India, Made in India compound. And we give these injections. One is cytokine formation blocker. One is cytokine blocker, receptor blocker. Cytokine formation blocker is itolizumab. And that is a very good agent. If we give it early, can prevent the need for oxygen, can reduce the cytokine storm, and it can be very useful, particularly in people, despite of steroids in 24 hours, they have not responded and the oxygen requirement is going up. Or we give a cytokine receptor blocker like tocilizumab, which is more useful if patient is ventilated. Then the next thing which we do is sometimes we give them BiPAP, non-invasive ventilator, or we have to ventilate these patients. If the doctor decides the patient needs ventilator, should be ventilated. Do not delay or defer. But now these both drugs are not available, then we use alternative drugs. Like there is a cancer substance called, you know, bevacizumab, and many other drugs have been used. There is one drug used in gout called colchicine. And in mild to moderate COVID, sometimes 0.5 milligram twice a day has been tried. It has evidence for and against it. Currently, NIH doesn't recommend it. Indian government protocol also has not recommended it right now. But it can be a useful drug and may get into the recommendations. So these are the agents. But the agents which save your lives are oxygen, prone position, supportive care, steroids, and low molecular heparin. Like we give a eclexane 0.54 twice a day. Look at it from the D-dimer standpoint. Or sometimes we use oral tablets. So this is how we manage COVID. Most of the COVID can be tailored and monitored from home. And once the patients come home, some of them still need nocturnal oxygen of 2 to 4 liters. There, those oxygen concentrators are very useful. Clearly, there is a role for steroid, there is a role for low molecular heparin, and there's a role for oxygen. Sometimes you know that our lungs normally are 60% expanded. We have the air sacs called alveoli, and they need to be expanded. So when they need to be expanded, we can do pranayama, we can do a lot of exercises, and we can recover. One of the aftermaths of steroids is very high diabetes. And you know, blood pressure and diabetes are two major comorbidities where people can die. So often, if the person is at home, we can manage them on oral tablets. But once they start steroids, sometimes we have to give them insulin. So we give them a long-acting insulin like glargine. And sometimes we can manage very well with insulin. We need to take a sugar testing machine, or we can use a continuous glucose meter, and we can monitor them and manage it well. Blood pressure medications also need to be enhanced, particularly for those 7 to 10 days when steroids have to be used. Unfortunately, steroids, this itolizumab, tocilizumab, they all can cause secondary infections after 21 days. And they can cause all this mucormycosis, which can go into the brain and the orbit. And sometimes you may have to do surgery and give antifungal agents. So remember that COVID is all about supportive care. COVID is about right time, right dose, and it's a timetable. So if we have to follow that timetable and go logically, without fear and without panic, we can conquer COVID. But you need a connectivity with the doctor. Now we are getting help from all over the world. But as I said, most of the COVID can be managed with good digital and telehealth consultation. I have also seen people across India. When I have in the first wave and in the second wave, even today I'm managing people across India, just digitally, and with only a provision that they should have an ability to go to the nearby hospital and get treated, should they need it. 80% can manage themselves at home. It is only those rare 20% which may need attention. We have to be very, very positive because you have to be isolated. So don't panic, don't think negative that I didn't get drug A, drug B, drug C. Because steroids are freely available, low molecular heparin is freely available. Oxygen also, I'm certain that by now all the shortcomings are taken care of. And various drugs, including remdesivir, also will be available, but their use is very limited. So do not think that because I'm not going to get something, get into a negative spiral. We have to be very, very positive and think. COVID can be mentally very agonizing and traumatizing. And I really get echoed by the words which Deepaji started his show with. It can have a traumatic impact on the mind, on the brain, on the heart, on the pancreas with diabetes, and various other organ systems. So COVID timetable for acute COVID stops at 14 to 21 days. But the post-COVID syndrome, which is called as a long-haul syndrome, can last for 3 months to 6 months. And then you are having people who are out of breath, which is called as lung fibrosis. They will still need some amount of antifibrotic drugs, some amount of inhaled steroids, nebulizers, and oxygen at home, and lung physiotherapy, and some pranayama. Then, of course, heart COVID. Many people get a lot of fast heartbeat. You get sinus inappropriate tachycardia, particularly in the evening where there's a little high-rise fever for 40, 50 days it lasts. And you feel very upset. Don't rush and keep doing tests. Just be patient. You will walk out of this. The next thing which happens is sometimes they get neuropsychiatric manifestations. I've had patients who have first time landed up with me like a Parkinson, like which they never thought they had COVID in the past. We did a COVID antibody, it was very high. I have patients who have landed up with Guillain-Barré syndrome. So we are seeing these neuropsychiatric manifestations of COVID. And a lot of people get depressed, whether they go to hospital, whether they go to, you know, at home, they get isolated, they are not able to connect with their family, the fear of death comes into them. So they need a lot of counseling. So counseling, nutrition is equally important in COVID care. And of course, physiotherapy is the key. Please use yoga. This is an ideal place to use yoga. And in the recovery phase, you can use a lot of immunomodulator drugs, including our homegrown Chyawanprash can help. So obviously, post-COVID care also needs a lot of care. Some people can get cardiac COVID and they can suddenly drop dead. So we have to ensure that we risk profile the patient. Some patients, we continue these anticoagulant medicines for 3 months if we particularly find that they are vulnerable for a cardiac pulmonary embolism like situation. So remember, the key to COVID care is being connected with the doctor and not being complacent 24/7, 365 days, at least for those 21 days for acute COVID. And unfortunately, if you linger on COVID for 3 months. Now, of course, we are in the vaccine era. So if somebody's got COVID, they'll ask me the next question, when should we take the vaccine? Usually after COVID, we recommend to take the vaccine after 3 months because you will develop some antibodies and those that will last you at least for 3 to 6 months. So after COVID, you get some degree of protection both from T and B cells. And we recommend you to take the vaccine after 3 months. Unfortunately, we are in the vaccination phase. Some people have got COVID after one dose of the vaccine. Even there, we tell them that a COVID which came after the first dose is like a booster dose. So you probably may not need a third dose, but if at all you have to take the second dose of the vaccine, take it after 3 months. So simple formula is 3 months. We have two vaccines in India, Covaxin, Covishield, and we can get post-COVID, we need to vaccinate. So I have a simple 1, 2, 3 formula. When do you take the second dose? For Covaxin, 1 month. For Covishield, 2 months. And if you have COVID, take it after 3 months. So make it simple in your mind. Don't make it complicated. COVID is all about common sense, being connected, being positive, but doing the right thing carefully. That's how COVID can be managed. Vaccines are safe. Vaccines are effective, but vaccines don't prevent infection. You can get a breakthrough infection even after one COVID and one vaccine. Don't get complacent. You will not die and you're unlikely to get severe COVID. Remember, these are early generation vaccines. We'll get many more vaccines coming up. Lot of people have questions on vaccines. You know, remember one thing, that it is there. Now we have had second wave. Will a third wave come? When will this wave go? A lot of people ask us questions. If you go by science, this is coming down. Some states it has started coming down. Delhi, it will still stay for another week or 2 weeks. Normally, Delhi follows a month after Mumbai. And from 3 to 6 months after that, maybe September onwards, we will have to be prepared for a third wave, which may again change the geography because the exposed population now is the people between 30 and 60, so it may go to children. But don't get scared if children get COVID. Below 10 children have an organ called thymus, which can clear virus very fast. And they're fully immunized. So usually you don't get complicated COVID with children, except a rare syndrome of MIS. Most COVID can be managed in children very well. So that is something which we need to recognize. But COVID appropriate behavior has to be followed 24/7, 365 days. So remember that in COVID, seek help without panic. Seek the correct help. Go to Government of India websites and websites which are appropriate and authenticated. Do not rely too much on WhatsApp University and Google because they sometimes give you a lot of clutter. You need to declutter. So our simple things can help. For example, lifestyle, whether you have COVID or no COVID, eat on time, eat slowly, eat the right thing, have some nutritious food, which is protein rich and less on carbs and less on fats. That's very crucial. Eat slowly. Then, of course, eating right is very crucial. Sometimes you might have to use nutritional supplements and powders to build on your health after COVID. Equally important is do some exercise. Do some physical activity at home. You can do brisk walk. You can do pranayama. You know, there is nose COVID, throat COVID, and lung COVID. For nose COVID, you can do simple kriyas like neti. Gargling is good. Betadine gargles are excellent. And of course, for lung COVID, you can do pranayama. remember, all these exercises help. Sometimes chanting religious mantras or beads or various rosaries or various other, you know, religions can help, because it will make your stress less, your anxiety less. We want to use all tools which will reduce anxiety. So physical activity is just not about doing Surya Namaskar or building muscles, but it is also important to do and chant something which will keep us engaged and meditate. Because we need to be positive and resilient, because we have to fight the virus. But just diet and exercise is not important. Smiling, de-stressing is equally important. And the most important thing in COVID, beyond diet, exercise, from lifestyle, is sleep. Getting good quality 7 to 8 hour sleep is very important. Don't get hooked on to digital world of a smartphone or a television or a Netflix or a computer screen. Ensure that you take 2 hours of digital detox every day. And ensure that you sleep for a good 7 to 8 hours, from 10 o'clock to 6 o'clock, because you know that at night, 10 to 11, we make those cytokines which are healthy, interleukin 8, interleukin 10, which actually are anti-COVID. So if you want to be into a COVID-free era where we build good, strong immunity, you need to eat the right food slowly, on time, appropriately. We need to build some good muscle, do some Surya Namaskar, do some chanting of mantras, or you can do any form of exercise you prefer at home. We need to ensure that we smile and don't stress yourself and others, and don't get anxious because of our phone and our WhatsApps and so many negativity which is coming. Be cheerful and positive. Be very, very strong and resilient. And remember that try to sleep on time and sleep adequately for a good 7 to 8 hours. Overall, if you follow this, and it's very easy for me to say, it's very, very tough to follow. Because as I said, we are in times of uncertainties. We are in times of adversities. We are in a state of helplessness. But we can only self-isolate, self-help our own selves by being strong. You can do it. We have to be Atmanirbhar. We have to be focused. We have to be positive. And we have to be clinical, because unless and until we don't do that, we can't navigate our journey and our country journey and world journey. Remember, it's a global problem. It is not a problem of Mumbai, Delhi alone. It's not a problem of Bengal or Tamil Nadu alone. It is not a problem of India or UK alone. It's a problem of the whole earth. We have 7 billion world global citizens, and we have to eradicate this virus from planet Earth by building some strong immunity and ensuring that we follow appropriate behavior, where we can't crowd for some time and we'll have to mask for some time. So I understand that all of us are restless as human beings. We sometimes get frustrated as human beings, but controlling emotions, controlling our own mind is really the only way we can negotiate this pandemic. Remember, Spanish flu lasted for 2 years. Usually most pandemic lasts for 2 years. So the timetable for COVID, which came in India last April, probably will last till March of 2022. Because most pandemics have a timetable of 18 to 24 months. Of course, COVID is predictably unpredictable. But by that time, we'll have a large population which will be covered by us. So remember, that is the way it is. I think I have talked too much. I'm certain that Sandeep and Deepaji and everybody else will have a lot of questions. I'll be more than happy to answer those questions. My whole idea of talking to you heart to heart without any slides is because it is just to tell you and give you some confidence how to handle this so-called pandemic. I had some domain expertise before I went into endocrinology of working very closely in HIV AIDS and immunology related to that in public health. And from 1989 to 1994, I was closely involved with the pandemic then of HIV AIDS. And then, of course, COVID pulled me back because I saw a case with COVID which had no COVID then, a senior citizen, 89 years old, who came with sugars of 500. And when we admitted him, we realized that that patient had COVID. And that opened my eyes that we are now in for trouble. But we know that nothing is impossible. So we have to go with positivity. We have to go with focus. And I'm reasonably certain that we have to have a mission. I'm sure that you'll have a lot of questions. And I'm certain that Sandeep will try to collate his questions, and we'll try to answer as many as we can.
Thank you, sir. First of all, thanks to you for making the talk so basic, and you have touched the real COVID care tips, which a normal human being because people are into a panicky situation, and in the panicky situation, the haywire actions people take. You talked about home care management, sir. You have also very well covered about the drugs and agents and various tests and the Indian government protocols also. I think you have made it very clear that the agent which can save life is oxygen, and most of the COVID cases be tailored and managed at home. You have talked about role of steroids. When the steroids we are taking it up, you have touched upon the topic about insulin fluctuations and blood sugar fluctuations, where the insulin can play a role. Even the BP the medications monitoring also needs enhancement once you are on steroids. You have also touched on that COVID is all about supportive, right time, right dose, need connectivity of the doctors, where the telemedicine, teleconsultations are playing a greater role, and 80% we can manage through this is also. The main thing which you have touched upon is that we have to be very positive, and we have to make an positive impact to the others also. Post-COVID syndrome also, sir, you have touched upon, and in which you have mentioned about neuropsychiatric manifestations of COVID. You have highlighted patient needs counseling, good nutrition, yoga, physiotherapy. Post-COVID needs huge care. And key to COVID care is only one, that is keep connecting with the doctors, not to be complacent. You talked about vaccinations also, schedule about the various vaccinations. And you also touched about that the third wave is going to start, and we should not be panicked, because any pandemic takes at least 2 years. And during COVID, seek right help. Don't rely on our WhatsApp University and the Google. And that is the infodemic word, which is creating a big, big myths among the mind of people. You have also put it up a very clear-cut thing that how to concentrate on a lifestyle management, which is the key, like pranayams and chanting and various ways. And the best point you have touched is good sleep is very important, 7 to 8 hours, 10 to 6 p.m. And take 2 hours of digital detoxification every day. And do not get anxious, be cheerful and positive. And overall, if you follow this, we may have to build a strong immunity and adopt a appropriate behavior. I think very, 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 very critical, a very, very clear point where you have covered all the aspects in a very simplified way. There are a lot of questions on the chat box. I have pulled up the chat box. If you can see. Yeah. So there are a lot of questions from the colleagues doctors have joined, healthcare professionals have joined from different parts of our country. I think the first question is the COVID pandemic, can we use alternative medicine for the control and prevention of COVID-19? And which vaccine is advisable for thalassemia patient?
I think alternative medications are at best adjuvants, and they need to be evidence-based and tested. So that's not a standard of care. Okay. So, you know, we respect alternative pathies. And they may have some immunomodulators, but you remember that some of these can have ingredients which could be steroids and metals. So we need to be cautious and careful, and they need to be using. And if at all it has to be given, it should be given by their specialist. We have excellent AYUSH specialists. So if under their supervision, mild COVID can be managed. Moderate and severe COVID, however, should not be managed. So I am reasonably certain that asymptomatic and mild COVID cases, you may still have a role for AYUSH. But when it is moderate or severe cases, one has to ensure the protocol is followed. As far as vaccination is concerned, thalassemic patients can get vaccinated. They are a high-risk group. We recommend whichever vaccine is available. But if the Covaxin is preferred by me personally, that's my personal choice. Government of India recommends both the vaccines.
Thank you, sir. What about fomite transmission? Because this is a very common thing. People are feeling that day-to-day items like vegetables, milk, people. So is there any chances?
Be clean, stay clean. It doesn't hurt. It will not only clean the COVID virus, but it will create so many other microbes. The incidence of gastrointestinal conditions has tremendously come down because of our cleanliness. So we should be clean, but we should be mindful of fomites. Fomite transmission has reduced, but it's not eliminated.
Thank you, sir. When this COVID crisis be over, because that you have already mentioned that the pandemic normally takes...
Probably, you know, we'll see better days after April of 2022.
Done. Is there any role of methylene blue in treating COVID?
No role. We have much better medications and strategies available than methylene.
Okay. why asymptomatic patients have ground glass opacity still present?
Because that is how COVID starts. And sometimes the asymptomatic people, our lungs are large. Every organ of our body is large. So till it is not affected more than 50%, you will not get classical manifestations. So we can still be asymptomatic and normal saturation with ground glass opacity.
Thank you, sir. If a person suddenly died due to COVID, why autopsy cannot be done?
That is because of a biohazard risk for the healthcare workers and their lives.
A COVID patient with the history of hemorrhagic stroke 2 years ago can be given anticoagulants or not?
Can be given with a lot of care under supervision of a neurologist and cardiologist. We have given it, but you have to be very cautious and careful, and we have to see what the residual neurological deficit left.
Thank you, sir.
What was the cause of hemorrhage in the first place? It has to be individualized. See, a lot of COVID care is individualized also.
It is that some of the doctors are prescribing these days FlaviFlu in a big way, and others are not even discontinuing it. It is recommended for second stage. If yes, can FlaviFlu is fine or safe in places of that since it is not available in the market?
No, FlaviFlu is very useful in mild COVID to moderate COVID in the first 3 days. After 3 to 5 days or 7 days after the viral replication has reduced, its utility really comes down. Secondly, should be avoided in people who have a gout, and should be avoided in people who are periconceptual. So obviously it is not yet, it has very good data to clear the virus. It is like, see, both the antiviral agents may enhance viral clearance or clinical recovery, but they don't save lives. So it's not a big deal if you don't give it, but if you catch the patient early in the first 72 hours, you may clear the virus faster.
Any role of steam inhalation, people, because people are adopting a lot of day-to-day home-based practices, and when it will be done by most, whether it is effective or not?
Steam inhalation is not really evidence-based. So it's not been recommended by most guidelines.
Okay,
but rather than that, doing a proper throat gargle with betadine or proper povidone iodine or proper cleanliness of the nose and native of the nose is far more relevant.
Significance of increased interleukin-6 in mild COVID-19 infections with slight increased CRP D-dimer and normal...
Interleukin-6, when you move it or keep the sample for 1 hour also, it can go up. If you don't analyze it in 1 hour, it will all be haywire. So don't rely too much on this.
Thank you, sir. Is tapering of steroid dose recommended if used in COVID-19 management?
For 7 to 10 days, no. But if it is given beyond 10 days, then you may need to taper it.
Thank you.
Very, very typical question. How to deal with a patient who is COVID positive and adamant and are not ready for any proper treatment? So this is a common issue which we all are facing. So I think, sir, what is your
biggest challenge? When we were talking, most people think 1 week may we will become okay.
Yes.
And they keep on managing it themselves. And then when they get into hypoxic, it's too late. So, you need to understand that nobody is smarter than you. And COVID is definitely more smarter than you. So listen to your doctor. And don't try to be extra smart, because the virus is smarter and your doctor is a little better than you in terms of handling it. So have some faith and be connected with the doctor. It is tough. Sometimes we have to use counseling sessions. Family members are the best counselors without panic.
Role of azithromycin and doxycycline in COVID, because these are all the general practitioners are making it in all their day-to-day practice to all the patients.
Data on azithromycin showed the negative trial. Data on doxycycline is weak. In monsoons, we use doxycyclines in last year, because when we get a fever in a monsoon, say in Mumbai, where there's a lot of monsoon, sometimes we use doxycycline. But azithromycin, clearly there's no data. Doxycycline may have some still data as a dual agent, but it has to be individualized. So currently, they are not on our protocols at all. Neither azithromycin, the data on azithromycin is clearly negative, neither doxycycline.
Role of anticoagulants are in COVID therapy.
Anticoagulants have a role in moderate cases or severe cases, and they definitely can make a difference.
If a person came into a contact of COVID patient, then how long he or she should wait for a vaccine?
Just by coming in contact, you don't have to wait for a vaccine. You will wait for a week probably. If you test negative, and then obviously you can wait for a week to 2 weeks. Normally we recommend then the vaccine to be taken after 15 days.
Thank you, sir.
If at all you are likely to be exposed also with COVID, then you are playing safe by getting the vaccine at appropriate.
There is a common queries going on, sir. The patient, some of the persons develop severe complications after taking the second dose of COVID vaccines. Could you throw some light on that?
We have seen that, but most people recover. But they do develop it. And it is not linked to the vaccine. People become complacent. They don't mask appropriately. And also the immunity comes down. Probably that's what people think. But people do get post-vaccine COVID, and we can manage it. But you need to be careful. Just because they're vaccinated, don't become complacent. Then they come very late and then they get complicated. Because there's a false sense of security, like wearing a helmet and driving a bike at 200 kilometers per hour. So that's why if you are vaccinated also, you can still get COVID. And you should be careful. And after that also, don't think that I'll just have mild disease. It may last you for 2 weeks.
Thank you, sir. Sir, there are a lot of mental health agonies which people are facing in the COVID-19 situation. And even if you see post-COVID, the mental health issues are going to be another pandemic situation. What are your thoughts on that, sir?
See, anguish is a part of our life. Anxiety and anguish is a part of our life. So, you know, Deepaji, before this program also was calling me at 5:59, anxiously, when am I joining? So that anxiety is there every time. In a previous job also, you know, all of us are busy. We need to handle anxiety, panic better. But it is serious. See, we are all under stress. There are dual stress on us. There is personal and professional stress. It is going to strain our economy. We need to be kind. We need to have gratitude. And we need to be positive. But a lot of hardship is there. So we need to be generous. And we need to be thankful to the Almighty that at least we are alive. We have air to breathe. And we have lungs which are free from COVID, which can make us, make and stay alive. So I think this is a war where we are fighting for air and oxygen. Everything else is secondary. So I think the whole idea is that we have to stay cheerful. We have to stay positive. Now, you will ask me that there's also grief. There's also death. If somebody has experienced death, then, you know, how do you conquer grief and death? And that's not easy. You know, it's difficult. It's difficult to grieve death, but you have to think that the person who lost, who's a near and dear one, how would he have thought that he should handle this whole episode? So we definitely need to seek counselor for psychiatric help if we feel negative. Don't feel shy. See, in India, we feel shy to take mental health care. If you feel that you are under anguish, under stress, under distress, under pressure, take and seek help. Don't feel shy.
Thank you, sir. There are a lot of queries which are coming up regarding the oxygen saturation, sir. What should be the normal level we should take it over that we should maintain? And when the panicky situation starts at home, that oxygen level moving below 90, whether there is a need to move to hospital? These are so many queries which has come on oxygen saturation.
I'll just put a very simple answer. A drop of 3% or below 93% needs oxygen and steroids. And we try to move these patients to corona care centers or hospitals. So in Mumbai, we are a little blessed because we have these big jumbo facilities. So we are able to move them to oxygen facilities. They may not need a bed, but we usually move them. We don't wait for it to fall down to 89 or something. Very clear, our yardstick is 93% or drop of 3%. Okay. If you don't get a bed, at least stay connected with your doctor will take a call.
Thank you, sir. Whether vaccination is contraindication in pregnancy, sir? COVID vaccine?
Oh, vaccination is not a contraindication in pregnancy. But, you know, pregnant women are, and women in general are more protected than men. The virus gets bug out faster in women than men because women are a biologically superior sex. And I think they have some degree of protection through estrogen. Children also are better protected, so are pregnant women. But pregnant women also have been recommended in the United States vaccination, but in India, government of India has not recommended because we don't have data in pregnancy.
Is there any use of taking prophylactic aspirin during the routine home management and during sir, we have seen few cases having high D-dimer levels post vaccination. Ideally, how many days post vaccination should we do and check D-dimer levels?
No, we don't check D-dimers after vaccine. Okay, only if somebody has underlying cardiac disease and is having some challenge or a problem. we sometimes rarely do it because of the coagulant. So under cardiological supervision, one can do it based on the cardiologist's recommendation. It is not a routine standard of care at all.
So now there is a lot of advocacy going on regarding the second dose of vaccine, which should be taken after 90 days if one got infected after first dose. What is the cutoff date if the patient is getting mild fever even few days?
So I'm very clear, Covaxin 1 month, Covishield 2 months. If you don't get your dose on time, if you delay Covaxin by 1.5 months and delay Covishield up to 3 months, it is okay. Keep it simple. Don't make it complicated. The more simple you are, the more focused you are, the more cheerful and positive you are, the easier it is. Okay. So my only motto is keep it simple and try to be very straightforward. So you're right, Covishield up to 3 months, 2 months is ideal, 1, 2, 3 months.
Sir, now being you as an endocrinologist, there is a question for you from diabetes point of view. A patient on oral medications on diabetes started taking steroids on the fifth day of fever. His blood sugar rises. What do you, whether we have to stop steroid gradually if oxygen saturation is within range or not?
No, for 7 to 10 days, we continue steroids. And what we do is we manage the diabetes better. Sometimes we have to add insulin like a 24-hour acting insulin like glargine and 8 to 10 units, 12 units. Sometimes we have to go up to 20 units to titrate and modify the oral agents also.
Okay. So whether vaccination is required in people taking the methotrexone and azithromycin, etc.?
So all disorders, rheumatic, immunological, cancer, or bleeding disorders, they all can be vaccinated, but their response will be different. So somebody has cancer and wants to take a vaccine. Somebody has a rheumatic disease on methotrexate or all these cyclophosphamide, wants to take a vaccine. Vaccine is recommended in them. But if they are on steroids, we tell them to reduce the dose under supervision of a specialist. And the specialist will decide what time to take it. For example, somebody undergoing active chemotherapy, we say that in between the 2 cycles of chemotherapy, take the vaccine. So I think the specialist doctor will advise that particular case, which is a special situation, when to take the vaccine, but vaccine should be used. Because these are a vulnerable group which can get COVID and succumb to COVID because of the other comorbidities. So it's very, very crucial, but that doctor should. So we have left it and kept it simple that the specialist, the rheumatologist, the cancer care, chemotherapy expert, the oncologist, they will decide.
Whether vaccination can prevent the asymptomatic carrier state or not?
No. Vaccine, even if you take vaccine, you can still get COVID and you may be asymptomatic.
So people are going for a lot of RT-PCR tests on repeats. When after home isolation, you will not infect, whether you can infect others or not, whether you are there in home isolation.
After 10 days, usually the virus is non-replicative. The current strain, I still prefer, my dictum is very clear, 14 to 21 days. So I say for 14 days, be strict on isolation. And even if you break the isolation chain, wear a double mask. Wear gloves and double mask and then mix with the people at home and have an airy environment. I am very clear about it. Because data will keep on changing. Our advice should be scientific, rationally driven, with the whatever little evidence based.
Thank you, sir. A lot of queries are there. What investigations we should do during the COVID suspected or a positive patient? Because labs are making people so much confused. Go for ferritin, go for D-dimer. Though you have touched upon in your
very clear. Yeah. 5th to 10th day, occasionally we do CBC. And CRP, that's good enough. Very rarely I add a D-dimer. Interleukin 6, ferritin, and LDH, I usually add not at home, but usually add in the hospital.
Thank you. Any preventive medicines that should be given to context of COVID patient to prevent infections to them?
See, in the good old days, the hydroxychloroquine was given. Currently, we don't recommend any. We recommend our best preventive medicine is still the mask, sanitization, and distance. So double mask is our new mantra.
You must be facing a lot of people, sir, using a role of ivermectin now. Ivermectin has come up in a big way. So what is your say for whether it can be used in COVID prophylaxis or a normal treatment?
It's anecdotal. Ivermectin is predominantly based on anecdotes with some data. We are the early users of ivermectin in Mumbai last year as early as March and April. And we have also generated our own data. We have tried to see it. I doubt whether with vaccines available, we need prophylaxis. Because vaccine is a far stronger prophylactic than any ivermectin on board. And as far as the treatment is concerned, also we have better treatment modalities. So technically, it is not standard of care. And the right dose of ivermectin is what we are struggling at. So in a trial which I did, I used doxycycline 100 mg BID for 5 days and 12 mg BID for ivermectin for 5 days. But that is our experience, which is also a small experience that cannot be a recommendation. ICMR also has put a question mark that it may be used. So currently, the data is not sufficient to give us a power to say that it should be used routinely. In prophylaxis, the answer is no. In treatment, the answer is maybe yes in mild cases. But data is not yet forthcoming. And we need to have more robust and large RCTs to use it. But if somebody is using ivermectin, I am not against it. So let me put it the other way around. I am not against the use of ivermectin. But I'm not for the use of ivermectin liberally and freely for one and all.
Can you tell about the fungal infection? The common infection people are facing is micromycosis, which is a complication of
COVID. Blue has become a very big problem in COVID. And that is because of diabetes and because of very high steroids. And when there is very high steroids which are used, then often we are getting this unusual fungal infection called mucormycosis. And sometimes we may have even lost lives because they get it in the eyes and the brain. It is called as rhinocerebral mucormycosis. We used to see it, and then we need to use these high-end drugs like liposomal amphotericin B and many other drugs. And therefore, we have to be very, very cautious and careful on liberal use of steroids. They have to be used aptly, appropriately, as well as various monoclonal antibodies, which harm the immunological system.
Thank you, sir. Last two questions, sir. What is your take that if a patient of CKD is having a COVID, any specific things which CKD patient we have to take care?
So we have specialized modules for that. In Mumbai particularly, dialysis has not stopped in COVID at all. And we have ensured that we have continued dialysis during COVID care also. We have tried to get them vaccinated also. And we have dedicated dialysis COVID units now, even in our jumbo facility.
If you see, sir, yesterday itself, this is from my side, yesterday Canada has announced the vaccination for their kids from 12 to 15 years. And there are a lot of questions I'm seeing on this chat box. People are asking whether the vaccination in India for kids are also going to be very soon, or is it recommended, or what are the things which you have for any trials going on? Any update on that, sir?
So Zydus Cadila is doing a trial between 12 to 18 years of old for the Zy-COVID, which is a DNA vaccine. So that data will be out end of this month. But don't be in a rush to give kids vaccines. Vaccines are most needed for vulnerable groups and comorbidities on people above 50. First, saturate them with vaccines. Then saturate the working class with vaccines. Then saturate children with vaccines. We cannot rush, because we remember our number of vaccines produced are finite. If we had vaccines for all, we would have given it for all. We agree that we need to give it for all, but we need to triage it and calibrate it in the right population who is most at risk to die. Our first principle is save every life. Our second principle is save every life which is likely to go to hospital and avoid ventilator. The third is try to avoid hospitalization. So in that order, we have to put a hierarchical preference. And when you are putting that hierarchical preference, we have to be very careful and calibrating in our approach. So yes, after a year, we will probably vaccinate our children. But right now, we don't have sufficient doses for them. Right now, we don't even need them from a public health standpoint, because we know children have good immunity. And probably what we need to think of right now is to vaccinate our vulnerable group above 50, at least more than 80% of our population. That is our first target. Please remember that.
Last question is effectiveness of the vaccination. Whether the Covishield or Covaxin, there are a lot of queries going on among the mind of the general public, which vaccine is best. Though we had a webinar, last webinar was on vaccination only. So does vaccination effective for all kind of strains in India? Because mutant, double strain, triple strains coming up. So what's your...
I'm very clear and clear on this. Vaccination saves lives. Vaccination saves severe COVID. Yes. And both Covishield and Covaxin have data in animal labs. or in laboratories against the mutant strain, both of them. Dr. Rakesh Mishra's group from CCMB in Hyderabad has published data for Covishield, and Covaxin has ICMR data from NIV. Both of them are effective against mutants. But viruses will change their antigenic structure. They will have these mutations. They will have their shifts and drifts. Like we change our clothes, like we change our glasses. So they will change. They will become smarter. We are human beings. We'll also become smarter. Like flu, every year we have a new vaccine. So I feel in the future, we will have quadrivalent vaccines. But the current vaccines may not prevent infection, but definitely will prevent severe disease and death. These are early generation vaccines. We have data against mutant for both Covaxin and Covishield. You might have an immune escape for Covishield. These are all hypothesis generating ideas for the scientific world to deliberate. But as a country, our government, as we see, remember, we are one of the largest, we are probably the second largest population in the world to be vaccinated. And even today, we have vaccinated at a very, very fast pace. You see, even if you go to other countries in Europe, you may still take 6 months and 8 months to get a vaccine done. So I think patience is the order of the game. And I think in Indians, we tend to be restless. So, you know, everybody is very, very restless. I can see you restless. I can see Deepa's back. So, you know, that means time is up. So, you know, I understand the restlessness. This is our DNA, our Indian DNA. We are all very restless individuals. I am not restless. I know what I have to do. So even if it takes a minute or two extra, it doesn't matter. But we need to understand that we need to be rested in peace because we want to be vaccinated. Now, you may not get your time for vaccine. It may take a little longer time. Till that time, please double mask. And even after taking a vaccine, please double mask, avoid crowds. That's all you need to do. And try to spread a positive message. Try to do a digital detox. Try to be cheerful. There is so much of negativity. Do meditation, listen to music, listen to movies you have never done, read books, visit every museum on planet Earth. It's virtually free available for everybody again. So you should understand that we need to divert and digress rather than ruminate and get stuck on to various negative news, which actually breed more negativity. So we need to understand how to conquer our mind. See, the virus in the mind is more deadlier than the virus in the body. Virus in the body, I can remove. As a doctor, we can have capabilities to take it out, but it is not the doctor who does the trick. It is the body's immune cells which remove the virus with the aid of some support. But the virus in the mind is impossible. You see, if the doubt is there in people's mind, it is very difficult. Changing human behavior, Sandeep, is very tough.
True, sir. Sir, since you are on a COVID task force of Mumbai and Maharashtra, sir, today there is a news in Times of India also that can Mumbai model be replicated for oxygen's utilization? Can you throw some light on this, sir? What is this Mumbai model for oxygen?
No, it's not just for oxygen. Basically, the Mumbai model is a very simple triage. It's better coordination. Yeah. So Mumbai has 24 wards. Each ward has a war room. It has a very, very clear patient focus center. Every patient who is positive is assessed by a team from BMC to decide whether usko hospital jane ki zarurat hai ki nahi, doctor ke saath connectivity hai ki nahi. And from there, if the person needs the hospital, a bed is organized and ambulance is set or a corona care center is there and they are sent. So basically, the whole approach is very patient-centric and human, and a 24/7, 12-hour shifts are there in the war rooms. So basically, it's a very professionally, scientifically driven model where we also, in oxygen utilization, we have had oxygen audits for every hospital, private and public. We ensure that there are sufficient supplies, and we are trying to limit the high flow nasal oxygen and try to put more of them into BiPAP and non-invasive ventilator strategies. We are trying to conserve oxygen. We are trying to optimally utilize oxygen so that there is no wastage, because we know that we are in a serious swamp. And we are still, even Mumbai, even now, is not out of the woods. We are still reporting 3,000, 4,000 cases. So even now, we are not out of the woods. So obviously, we have to be very, very cautious and careful. The war is on and we will succeed. We are very determined. Only thing is, it is more organized at public and private sector. And it has these war rooms which have clearly made a difference, because each Mumbai, there are 24 Mumbais. Each ward officer is like the commissioner. And each ward officer has under him a war room with a team of doctors and medical students who are ready to be there. Everybody, they get the report first. The patient doesn't get the report. So they know in their geography who's positive. They disclose the report, go to the patient, move out the patient where the patient is. So obviously it's a much more structured approach and everything is 100% transparent. There is nothing you can go, everything is in public domain. I can send you the whole Mumbai model on a PDF file, which I will send you, Sandeep. And you should have a look at it because you know it's very, very transparent. Okay, what is the bed availability? What is the dashboard? So, you know, everything is in public domain. So it's a very well-proven, well-oiled model. Task force has been also guiding them as much as they can and hand-holding them because it's something which we know that Mumbai is very, very populated. We have these local trains, we have these buses, they are so overcrowded. So we had to fight adversity and we still have to have our livelihood and economy. Of course, in that Mumbai model, a big success is also because of severe restrictions on time. When we realized that the bump is too fast, too quick, we immediately had a lockdown-like restrictions and we have closed down. And we are not in any hurry to open it up. Because that's the second thing, that we had to close down and lock the economy. So if some places, some stringent measures are required, they must be taken.
Thank you, sir. Positive tips, since your topic is COVID care tips, I will say any last positive tips for our all medical fraternity and for all of us from your side, sir?
No, I think stay safe, have a good sleep, be cheerful, and try to do a digital detox for 2 hours every day. You know, even if you don't see this video, it is fine. Okay, you don't have to because it's too much time. You know, actually our human attention span is so less that ideally no program should be more than 20 minutes. But I think COVID has humbled us. And don't try to outsmart a virus and don't try to outsmart human beings. Learn to cooperate with your healthcare providers and your family members. And if you get COVID, don't panic. Be careful and let's all pray that sometimes you might have issues related to access. Let's all pray that every Indian and every global citizen gets the right COVID care at the right time so that we can come out of this pandemic successfully. And I'm certain that we'll have the, you know, after Corona era, AC era soon, probably maybe next year, so that I can meet my good friend Sandeep for coffee, you know, maybe in Mumbai or Delhi. I don't know where he'll still be, probably in Delhi, but at least that all is gone now. So, you know, those things, and they hurt. See, as human beings, all this hurts because I can't just talk. You know, we're just now all digitally connected. So much of, you know, digital energy is going, but we're not able to meet. And that physical meeting is still the physical meeting. So it's something important. But I think sometimes sacrifices are needed. So this is a sacrifice each one of us has to do for us to keep ourselves safe. So be safe, be cheerful, smile, and, you know, be grateful. Have some gratitude and kindness and try to do some act of gratitude. Lot of people are not as blessed as you and me. There are many more unfortunate people. See if you can give them a little help with gratitude. It will make a lot of difference to their lives.
Thank you, sir. I will conclude that we are in a trying circumstances and we don't know what future holds. We need to prepare for the worst case scenario and hope for the best. And I'm sure, sir, time is very soon when this pandemic will be over. And I will see you on a face-to-face, though this is a digital way, and we will have a cup of coffee soon. And we will pray for the safety of every colleagues and everybody, all nooks and corners of our global world. And I pray that Almighty should bless us and this time should pass on fast. And let us adopt all the preventive measures. We are strong, virus is not strong. If we become more stronger, virus will automatically has to take a different shape altogether. So thank you on behalf of India, sir, for joining. I will hand it over to my colleague Deepa now to conclude the thing. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Joshi, for such a wonderful and informative session. For the participants, there is a link on the chat box for today's session. Kindly fill in that and give us your feedback. Let us know how we can further improve our sessions. Our next session of the series on COVID-19 is scheduled on May 9th, 2021, which will be moderated by Dr. Sanjay Kalra. The guest speakers will be Dr. Vinny Kantru and Dr. Varun Arora. The topics will be home care management and COVID-19 and levels of prevention. Do register yourself on the same link and see you soon. Thank you all for your participation. Have a wonderful evening ahead. Stay safe and healthy. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, sir.